Well, good morning, folks. It's great to see you this morning. It's good to be gathered in to worship the Lord. My name is Trevor, and I'm the minister here. If you're visiting with us, I hope that you feel welcome amongst us. On your way in this morning, you should have got a little bulletin that has details of what's happening over the coming week in it, but please just allow me to highlight a few things as we begin. We're going to meet this evening for worship at 7 o'clock. We're going to have our Festival of Carols and lessons, followed by, I was going to promise mince pie and shortbread, but I don't know that I can promise that. I'll promise seasonal refreshments instead, and hopefully it's mince pies and shortbread. Isn't that right, Wilva? We're doing all right? Okay, perfect. So please plan to come along to that if you can. 7 o'clock tonight, it'll be a great night of music and a great night of singing God's praise together. Just to say that there is no midweek either this week or the 28th, but we will be back in the start of January. Next Sunday, we've moved to the slightly earlier time of half past 11 next Sunday, but we will be meeting for worship. And then two final announcements. Can the committee please note that the free will offering envelopes are ready and they're up in the photocopier room. So if that applies to you, please pick up those envelopes to distribute them as soon as possible. And then the final one is just to say that we are hoping to relaunch the home groups in January. In order to give us an idea of how many people are going to be involved and how many people want to be involved, there are sign-up sheets in the porch on the table there. Please sign those just to give us a rough idea. You're not signing your life away and you're not committing yourself to anything, but it'll help us to have a vague idea of how many folks are interested in being part of the Grow groups once again. So if you would like to be involved in a Grow group, please sign up on the sheet at the back. Well, I trust that they're all the announcements. Let's hear together God's word as we come to worship him. We're continuing this morning to think about this whole idea of Jesus in the Old Testament, of the promise of the incarnation in the Old Testament, considering today the passage in Micah chapter 5. But as our call to worship, we hear the words of Luke, who tells us in chapter 1, verse 32, speaking about Jesus, he will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. As we gather here Sunday by Sunday, we're reminding ourselves of these truths, that of the kingdom of Jesus Christ there is no end, that it continues Sunday by Sunday, that it continues month by month, that it continues year by year. He is the forever King. As we come together to praise God, I invite you to stand if you're able as we sing our opening hymn, See in Yonder Manger Low.
Thank you.
let's join our hearts together in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we gather together this morning, we give you thanks for the birth of your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for the example of humility that he sets us, as Paul reminds us in that great passage, that he thought not equality with God a thing to be grasped, but instead humbled himself. We thank you, Father, that Christ's humiliation was not complete in being born as man, but that he came as a servant. We thank you, Father, that he came and that he died that death that was the lowest of the low, that was reserved for the traitors, that was reserved for the murderers. But yet we thank you this morning, Heavenly Father, that Christ reigns and resides at your right hand in power and in glory. We thank you for the assurance that it is that he sits there and he intercedes for us as his people. That he, Heavenly Father, pleads our case before your throne of grace. That despite all of our sin, despite all of the ways that we fail you, despite all of the ways, Father, that we choose to go our own way instead of your way, that Christ is there seated at your right hand. That those wounds remind us that the price has been paid, that it is finished. What a marvel it is, Father, this morning that we have a mediator such as he. One who was tempted in every way just as we are and yet without sin. We thank you this morning, Father, for the encouragement that it gives us to think on Christ. To think on him as that baby in the manger. So fragile, so vulnerable. In need of care and protection, yet equally, fully God. We confess, Father, that we cannot fully grasp and wrap our minds around that truth. But we thank you for the incarnation. We thank you for the wonder of Christmas. The wonder of Christmas, not in the baubles and lights and tinsel, not in the presents and all that will come with it, but in the wonder of Emmanuel, God with us. We pray, Heavenly Father, for ourselves now that you would go before us into this time of worship. We pray that you would bless us as we meet together around your word. And we pray, Father, that all that is done and said and sung would be done and said and sung to your honor and to your glory this morning, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're going to have our Bible reading now. It's from the prophet Micah. If you're struggling to find Micah, the easiest thing to do is probably to go to Matthew's Gospel and turn back a few books, and you'll get there. Micah's towards the end of the Old Testament. So if you go to Matthew and turn back a few books, you'll get to the prophet Micah. And we're going to read from chapter 5. Micah chapter 5, beginning to read at verse 1. This is the word of God. Now, muster your troops, O daughter of troops. Siege is laid against us. With a rod they strike the judge of Israel on the cheek. But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has given birth. Then the rest of his brothers shall return to the people Israel. And he shall stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall dwell secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be their peace. When the Assyrians comes into our land and treads in our palaces, Then we will rise up against him 7 shepherds and 8 princes of men. They shall shepherd the land of Assyria with the sword, and the land of Nimrod at its entrances. And he shall deliver us from the Assyrian when he comes into our land and treads within our border. Then the remnant of Jacob shall be in the midst of many peoples, like dew from the Lord, like showers on the grass, which delay not for a man, nor wait for the children of man. And the remnant of Jacob shall be among the nations, in the midst of many peoples, like a lion among the beasts of the forest, like a young lion among the flocks of the sheep, which, when it goes through, treads down and tears in pieces, and there is none to deliver. Your hand shall be lifted up over your adversaries, and all your enemies shall be cut off. And in that day, declares the Lord, I will cut off your horses from among you, and will destroy your chariots. And I will cut off the cities of your land, and throw down all your strongholds. And I will cut off sorceries from your hand, and you shall have no more tellers of fortunes. And I will cut off your carved images and your pillars from among you. And you shall bow down no more to the work of your hands. And I will root out your Asherah images from among you and destroy your cities. And in anger and wrath, I will execute vengeance on the nations that did not obey. Amen. This is reading of God's inspired and inerrant word, and we trust that God will bless the reading of his word to our souls. Well, boys and girls, if you want to come down to the front, I'll come down and meet you just now. Come on ahead. I like your jumper, Alfie. You've gone all out for Christmas in the Bonner household today, have we? Yeah? Okay, well, maybe ask someone else then. It's good to see you this morning, boys and girls. It's good to be gathered together again. Your jumper plays a tune, doesn't it? Is your t-shirt plays a tune? Okay, very good. Very good. It's good to see you, boys and girls. Now, who is glad that we are back in church this week? Anyone glad that we're back in church this week? Nearly. Don't like the hall?
No.
Why not? Too cold.
I like being in church.
You like being in church? Well, it was probably a lot colder in church than the hall, to be fair. Who knows why we had to go to the hall for a couple of weeks? Daniel.
Because the
heating was broke in here. It was very cold in here. If you thought the hall was bad, here was even worse. It started out something very, very simple as to how the heating broke, because the pipes were expanding whenever they got warm and then contracting whenever they, and little bits of water were getting out gradually over the years. Little bit of water, little bit of water, little bit of water. Cracked, corroded the pipe, and then more and more and more and more and more. This morning from the prophet Micah, we were told about a little place. This was a little place called Bethlehem. And everyone thought this place was insignificant. Everybody thought this place had nothing going for it. Everybody thought this place was a real backwater, that there was nothing good ever going to come from it. But the prophet Micah told us that from Bethlehem would come God's forever king, would come God's promised king, would come who? Jesus.
From this little insignificant place that no one cared about was going to come God's forever king. And you know, sometimes, boys and girls, we might think that we are small and insignificant. We might think that we can't do much. But if we have faith in God, and if we have faith in Jesus as our Savior, then we can be sure that God will help us wherever we are, and God will help us to do what He wants us to do. From little, small, insignificant places, great things can happen. Let's pray together now. Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank You that He came not to be a powerful king, not to be a mighty ruler in an earthly sense, but He came to give His life as a ransom for many. We thank You that He has taken away our sins. We thank You that His coming was told from of old. We thank You for the boys and girls. We thank You for their faithfulness in turning up week by week. And we pray, Father, You would bless them at this Christmas time. Pray that You keep Your hand upon them, watching over them, protect them, we ask. And bless them now as they head out to Children's Church, we ask. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, boys and girls. Go back to your seats now.
Well, we're going to stand and sing again, this time the hymn, Away in a Manger. Let's continue our worship of God as our offering is received. Join our hearts together in prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the way that you have so ordered your church, so constructed your church, for the commands that you give us in Scripture. We thank you, Father, this morning that one of those commands is to bear one another's burdens, to pray for one another. And so as we come this morning, Heavenly Father, we want to remember before you those who are struggling this morning, those who are struggling with ill health. We think especially of Bertie this morning, Father, asking that you be near to him in the days that lie ahead. We thank you for the way that you've strengthened him over these past couple of days. And we pray, Father, that upward trajectory might continue. We pray that the antibiotics that he's on might stop and take away the infection that he has. We pray, Father, that you would strengthen him and give him all the grace that he needs. We remember George and Anne and Sam before you this morning, Father, asking again that you would be close to them as George continues his treatment. We pray, Father, that you would enable them to get some rest over this incoming week. We pray, Father, that even though Christmas might be somewhat different for them this year, Father, that they might know your hand of blessing resting upon them. We pray that the treatment that George is having would be effective, would be successful. And we just pray, Father, that you would give to him all the strength that he needs. Give to Anne and Sam all the grace that they need as they continue to watch on. Remember others within the congregation who likewise are suffering physically. We pray, Father, that you would be close to them. We recognize this morning that there are many who are carrying burdens that we know nothing about and we can't see. We just continue to pray, Father, that you give them the grace that they need. Continue to be close to them. Continue to build them up. Continue to strengthen them, we ask. We pray that if they need help, that they would reach out for it. Remove any sense of shame and embarrassment that they might have. And entrust them to this fellowship here, we ask. As we come this morning, Heavenly Father, we also recognize that at this season of great joy and expectation, there are some who, for whom Christmas will be a difficult time. Christmas will be a reminder of a loved one who is not here. It will be a reminder of perhaps a death that has occurred in this past year. For some, Christmas might bring feelings of isolation, of being alone. We just pray once again, Father, that you be near to these people, that you would give them all the grace that they need. Give them all the strength that they need over this next wee while. We pray for ourselves, Father, for our carol service this evening, asking that you would bless in this endeavor. We pray for the musicians and for the choir who will take part, Father. May be a good evening of singing praise to your name and a good evening of encouragement and fellowship together. Bless all those who will take part, we ask. Remember the situation in our world, Father. As we see it unfold week by week, we're reminded that it's a world that's out of step with its creator. That it's a world that is no longer the very good world that you made, but it's a world that has been infected and marred in every area by sin. And as we come this morning, Father, we want to pray that you would restrain the hands of those who seek to do evil, who seek violence and bloodshed. Whether that's on our streets, whether that's in the Ukraine, whether that's in Afghanistan, wherever it is. May people be mindful of the sanctity of human life. Mindful that people are created in the image of God. Mindful that one day we will be called to give an account of our lives. We pray for ourselves now, Father, that as we come to study your word, that you would write it on our hearts. that you would soften our hard hearts and we might know your grace going before us, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. Just before we consider that passage in Micah 5, we're going to stand and sing again, this time the words of the hymn, "Joy to the World, the Lord has come." Well, if you have a Bible with you, I encourage you to have it open at Micah chapter 5, so that we can see what God is saying to us together this morning through his word. It's probably fair to say that Christmas time, that festive season, is a time when we look forward to the arrival of friends and family coming to visit us, or perhaps we're arriving with them, we're traveling to see them. There's the obvious reason that we enjoy that, because we enjoy spending time with our friends and family, with our loved ones, catching up with those who we maybe haven't actually seen since last Christmas. But yet I think there's something deeper than that as well. Rather than just the purely human companion aspect of it, there is a deeper dimension. There's the expectation that whenever this person arrives, all will be well. That whenever this person arrives, everything is going to be settled. We will feel at ease. Whenever we get together with this person, all will be as it should be. The world will feel right. And as we come to Micah chapter 5 this morning, we come to the prophet looking ahead for the arrival of a savior. And in the ultimate sense, whenever this savior arrives, all will be well. All of the wrongs will be put right. All of the dark things will be made light once this Savior comes. Truly, once this Savior arrives, all will be well. When he comes, the oppression that the people have been living under will be relieved. When he comes, the right relationship with God that has been broken by sin will be restored. When he comes, all will be well. We want to see three things from Micah chapter 3, see three things together this morning. Firstly, we want to think about this idea that he will be their peace. That's the image that the prophet conveys to us, that whenever this king arrives, he will be their peace. Secondly, we want to think about the idea that he will deliver us. That's the great assurance that the prophet holds out in verses 5 and 6, that this coming king will deliver us. But then thirdly and finally, as a warning, we'll see that judgment comes because they did not obey. Judgment comes because people refuse to accept and listen to this king. He shall be their peace, he shall deliver us, and they did not obey. So firstly then, he shall be their peace. And we see that in verses 1 through 5a of Micah chapter 5. And as we begin chapter 5, and as we come to verse 1 of Micah chapter 5, we notice that there's a problem, don't we? Because what's the first instruction that the prophet issues to the people? Muster your troops, O daughter of troops. Now, when do you need to muster your troops? There's not much point mustering your troops whenever everything's well, whenever there's peace within the land, is there? You don't muster your troops when there's no enemy to be fought, when there's no threat on the horizon. No, rather, you muster your troops. You get your troops together when there's a war, when there's conflict, when there's trouble on your doorstep. So right away, as we come to verse 1, we see that there's trouble. We see that there's something wrong. We see that there's an enemy that needs to be fought. And we see that as we come, verse 1 then. Muster your troops, okay. Siege is laid against us. With a rod, they strike the judge of Israel on the cheek. A rod here is used as a symbol of power. It's used as a symbol of authority. And the people of Israel, the ruler of Israel, has no power, has no authority, has no reign left. Because he's being struck repeatedly on the cheek with the rod. Shows us how powerless Israel is. Shows us how powerless their ruler is. They can't even lift their hands to defend themselves. They can't even lift their hands to cover their face. I tuned in last night to the tail end of a boxing match that was being broadcast on TV. And one of the boxers had got knocked out. Whenever he fell to the floor, he was utterly powerless. He couldn't defend himself. He couldn't put his hands up to cover his face. He was just gone. And that's the image that's conveyed here. That the ruler of Israel, the judge of Israel, is being struck repeatedly on the cheek. There's nothing he can do about it. There's no power that he has. There's no influence that he can exert. He is being repeatedly struck. But then the gospel comes, the good news comes, verse 2. But you, O Bethlehem Ephrathah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel. Here we have the wrong being put right. We have the judge who is powerless. We have the ruler who's powerless. Verse 1. But that's not going to be the case forever because there's coming a king. Verse 2. There's one coming who will be powerful. There's one coming who's going to be raised up to be the ruler in Israel. But as we thought about with the boys and girls, his beginnings are quite inconspicuous, aren't they? He will come forth from Bethlehem Ephrathah. It's a small, insignificant tribe. It's a tribe that was too small even to be listed amongst the clans of Israel, even amongst the tribes of Judah. But as we read that, our church history, our Bible history should be ringing. It was, of course, the tribe that King David had come from. King David, the man after God's own heart. King David, the one who was promised to Samuel 7 that he would have a man to sit on the throne of Israel forever. And now in Micah chapter 5, we have this promise of a ruler who's going to come. One who will follow in David's line. One who will be the ruler of his people, Israel. In comparison to the impotent king of verse 1, a new king will arise. In comparison to the king who couldn't defend himself, verse 1, a new king will come. But notice what we're told about him at the end of verse 2. Who's coming forth is from of old, from ancient of days. Now, as we read that, what do we think of? What image does it convey in our mind? Is that more importantly for us actually this morning, as the people in Micah's day read that, what would they have thought about? The ancient of days is, of course, a reference to God himself. So this ruler who comes forth from the Ancient of Days is a ruler who's chosen by God, who is picked by God. And again, as we think about that promise, we've thought about to Moses in Deuteronomy 18. We've thought about it in John's Gospel week after week. That great promise that was made to Moses that after me, after you, Moses, I would raise up a prophet like you from among your own brethren. So as Micah prophesies to the people here, as the Lord speaks to the people through Micah about this one who is from of old, from ancient of days, I've no doubt that their mind went to that prophecy of Moses. I've no doubt that they expected the one like Moses to come. This one who would be nothing less than God himself. Now, as we look back on the promise from this side of the incarnation, we see Christ, don't we? We see the one who will be the ruler in Israel, the one who was born in inconspicuous circumstances. But that misses what I think we're being told here in Micah chapter 5. Because this ruler who's coming, this king who's coming, is from of old. This king who's coming is from the Ancient of Days. What we see here is the wonderful truth of the pre-existence of Jesus Christ. He is the one who is from of old. He is the one who is from Ancient of Days. He is the one who is God himself. You see, as we come to the Christmas season, it's tempting, if not overtly, certainly in our subconscious, it's tempting to think of Christ coming into existence at Christmas time. Christ coming into existence as that baby. And it's important to say this morning that while Jesus Christ was born, that he has always been. That while there was a moment where Christ came to earth, he is the eternal existing Son of God. There was never a point where he came to be. He is, as Micah puts it here, of old. He is of the Ancient of Days. I studied religious education at A level. Despite Joyce Barclay's best efforts, I managed to see at A level RE. I don't know if I should have told you that or not, but there we go. It's out there now. But one of the very few things that I remember from my A level RE class was Mrs. Barclay had this little saying about Arius, one of the first heretics of the church. Arius had this little saying that there was when he was not. That there was a time when Christ came into existence. That there was a time when Christ was not. But the point that's being made here in Micah chapter 5 is actually that there was never a time when Christ was not. That he is the eternally existent Son of God. There was a time when he was born, yes, but there was never a time when he was not. Now you might think, well, why does that matter this morning? What's the significance of that? Well, it matters because of who we claim Christ to be. We claim that he is both fully God and fully man. If he is not eternally existent, if he is not the eternal Son of God, if there was a moment where Christ came into existence, then he is not God. He may be like a God, but he is not God. But as we come to verse 4, we see a wonderful picture of what Christ would do for his people, don't we? That he will shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord. John's gospel that we've thought about, that's one of the central themes, isn't it? It's one of the central ideas that John conveys to us. That Jesus is the good shepherd. And what does the good shepherd do? He lays down his life for the sheep. The assurance, verse 4, that he came not to do his own will, but the will of the Lord who sent him. It's the Lord's glory that would be his central mission, his central concern on earth. And what's all the result of this going to be? What's going to happen because this new king has arisen? We've seen the impotence of the king, verse 1. We've seen his powerlessness, verse 1. But what happens when this new king comes? What happens as he shepherds his people? What happens as he looks to do the will of the Lord? Well, verse 4 tells us, they shall dwell secure, for he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be their peace. Because this new king has come, there's no need for the people to fear the Assyrians anymore. Because this new king has come, there's no threat that can undermine them. There's no threat that can worry them. Because this new king has come, the people can live in peace and safety. The people can dwell secure. It's what Christ does for us this morning, isn't it? Because of his perfect life, because of his perfect death, because he sits at God's right hand and intercedes for us this morning, we can dwell secure. We can live in peace and safety and harmony. We can dwell secure knowing that our salvation isn't dependent on us. It doesn't depend on how good we are. It doesn't depend on how religious we are. It doesn't depend on all our good works, but it depends on Him. And so if we look to Christ this morning, we can dwell secure. Because it's not about us, but it's about Him. If it was down to us, we could never dwell secure, could we? We could never live in that peace. Because how would I know that I've been good enough? How would I know that I've kept enough rules? How would I know that I've done enough in my own strength to be right with God? But as it is this morning, we can dwell secure because it's all about Christ, the one who shepherds us, the one in whose righteousness we can rest this morning, the one in whose goodness we can rest this morning. He is our peace with God. But do you know that for yourself this morning? Do you know the reality of Christ being your peace, of Christ being your shepherd? Secondly, then, we think about this idea, He shall deliver us, He shall deliver us. And we see that in verses 5b down through verse 6. And as we come to this section, I think it's probably important to say that it's a little bit more difficult to understand. It's a little bit more difficult to work out what's going on in verses 5b and 6. But what we have at 5b is the idea of a threat. The idea of a foreign army coming and invading the land, verse 5, when the Assyrian comes into our land and treads in our palaces. It's essentially what we've had in verse 1, isn't it? The troops are being mustered, the army's being called together because there's a foreign power invading. Verse 1, though, we saw the impotence of the king, we saw the powerlessness of the king. But actually we see here as we come to verse 5 how this situation has been reversed. Because the Assyrians come into the land, verse 5b, and what happens now? Well, we're told that we will raise against him 7 shepherds and 8 princes of men. As we see this term shepherds here, we're not thinking about a sort of literal shepherd. A shepherd was an imagery that was used by the prophets to convey the idea of a king. The king would be one who would shepherd the people, who would look after the people. So as we come here to verse 5 and this idea of 7 shepherds, we're talking about a king. 7 in the Bible is the number of perfection, it's the number of completeness, 7 days of the week, etc., etc. So what we're talking about here is an all-powerful, all-glorious king, the king. And when the Assyrians come into the land, this king is going to be raised against them. The prophet's saying here that the people's strength is restored. No longer is it going to be, verse 1, shame and defeat. No longer is it going to be the king being carried away. But there are people who are ready to defend the cause of the people. So that's the first thing to say. But then we come to verse 6, which changes the picture again. Because we're told that they shall shepherd the land of Assyria with a sword, and the land of Nimrod at its entrances. So not only do we have the land being defended, the people being defended, verse 5, what we have now is actually the kingdom being extended, verse 6. That it's not just the land of Israel that these people will rule, but actually they'll go on the offensive, that they'll take over the land of Assyria. The picture is one of total reversal from what we read in verse 1. The people are no longer afraid of their enemies, but now their enemies have been defeated. The people no longer worry about what it is that's coming over the hill, but the people are now so secure and dwell so greatly that they actually go on the offensive. They watch over the land of Nimrod at its entrances, keeping check on who's going out and coming in. And how can they do this? What's changed from verse 1? Well, it's the coming of the king. It's the coming of the promised king. It's the coming of Christ. He shall deliver us, verse 6, from the Assyrians. Who is the he? It's the one who's from of old. It's the one who's from God. It's the one who's from the Ancient of Days. Of course, this points us supremely this morning to Christ. In the history of the people of Israel, there were many kings who were raised up, some of them better than others. But Christ is the King, the perfect King, the one who has liberated us, the one who has delivered us, the one who has set us free, not from the Assyrians, but the one who has set us free this morning from bondage to sin. The one who has set us free this morning from the domain of darkness and brought us into his kingdom of light. The one who has freed us this morning from sins and trespasses. Christ is the one who liberates us this morning. Christ is the one who delivers us this morning, the one who sets us free. He's delivered us from the devil and hell this morning. We remember his great promise from John's gospel. What is it that Christ says? If the Son sets you free, you shall be free indeed. Truly this morning, friends, we have been set free in Christ. But if you have been freed through faith in Christ this morning, are you living like you're free? Are you enjoying your freedom in Christ? Are you living that life of freedom in Christ? Are you submitting yourself once again to a yoke of bondage? Are you once again giving yourself over to sin and death? Thirdly, finally, this morning, then we think about this whole idea that they did not obey, and we see that in verses 7 through 15. This is a slightly darker section of the prophecy that we rarely get to with the thought of the coming of Christ. Pronounces the Lord's judgment on the nation of Israel, but ultimately on the world as a whole. We see verse 7, the remnant of Jacob are scattered. The remnant of Jacob shall be in the midst of many peoples. They're dispersed throughout the lands and throughout the nations. They're like dew from the Lord, like showers on the grass. Speaks to us of a positive influence that the people of God are having. In a very arid, very dry climate, the dew would have been essential to the health of the plants. It would have been essential to the fertility of the region. And God says here, so too will the people of Israel be, will the people of Jacob be, as they're dispersed throughout the nations. But the focus shifts in verse 8. We've had the blessing of them, verse 7. But this remnant, as they're amongst the nations, verse 8, what are we told about them? Will be like a lion among the beasts of the forest, like a young lion among the flocks of the sheep, which when it goes through, treads down and tears in pieces, and there is none to deliver. As well as being a blessing, the people of God would be a curse. As well as being a blessing to the nations, the people of God would bring judgment to the nations. God would fight for them. God would protect them. And God will work to bring them back from exile. God will judge the nations because of his people's presence amongst them. And the Lord brings the people to the point of realization. Brings the people to that point of brokenness. Takes away every other thing that they might be tempted to trust in to show them that he alone is God. Verse 10. In that day, declares the Lord, I will cut off your horses from among you. Your chariots are destroyed. There's military might and strength gone. Horses, chariots destroyed. The cities of your land and all the strongholds, all those places that you think are safe and secure, gone. He moves into more spiritual realms in verse 12. Your sorceries will be cut off from your hand. No more tellers of fortunes will live in your cities. Those things that you look to, those things that you look to for guidance and hope and inspiration are gone. Verse 13, your idols will be removed, the pillars cut down. The Asherah is gone. Verse 14, everything that the people look to, everything that the people put their trust in is gone. And it brings them to that moment where they realize that the Lord alone is God. Oftentimes the Lord will bring us to that point where everything else has failed. Everything else has broken and everything else has let us down to show us that He is God and that there is no other. As we live through the days that we're living through, it feels like the Lord is reminding us that He is God, doesn't it? All those things that people put their trust in, all of those things that people put their faith in, are being systematically taken away one by one. We've had COVID that's wiped out people's sense of physical health being the ultimate thing that they're looking to provide protection. We're having this cost of living crisis where people's identity and money is being stripped away as the thing that will give them protection. God is reminding us, friends, that He alone is God and there is no other. That all of those things that we're tempted to put our trust in are being stripped away to bring us to God, to show us His unfailing love. But notice as we finish verse 15 what we're told. And in anger and wrath I will execute vengeance on the nations that did not obey. Why are the nations judged? Why is the Lord's vengeance fall on them? Because they did not obey. Why will we be judged this morning? Why will we be cast off this morning? Quite simply, if we have not obeyed, if we've not repented, if we've not turned to faith in Christ, all that remains is the fearful expectation of judgment. You see, we approach this Christmas season and we think of that baby in the manger. We think of that king who was promised, verse 2. But it's easy to forget that that baby in the manger is our peace this morning, that He is our peace with God. It's easy to forget that that baby in the manger is our king this morning, the one who has brought us right relationship with God. We forget that that baby in the manger is the one whom we must obey, the one whom we must listen to. The nations didn't obey, verse 15, and experienced God's judgment. The babe in the manger is the one who's appointed for the rising and falling of many. But do you know Him this morning? Do you know that freedom that He brings? Rejoice in Him by all means. Celebrate His birth by all means. Rejoice most of all this morning in the hope of Emmanuel, God with us. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your Son Jesus Christ this morning. We thank You that He is the one whose birth was foretold from of old. We thank You that He is the one this morning who brings us right relationship with You, that He is the one in whom our hope is based this morning. We confess, Father, that this passage gives us ample warning of the dangers of not listening, of the dangers of not responding to Christ. May we always respond to Him with faith and obedience. May we always have hearts that are ready to listen and to put into practice His word, we ask. Continue with us now and bless us, we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as we bring our time of worship to a close this morning, we're going to stand again if we're able and sing the words of the hymn, Hark the Herald, Angels Sing, Glory to the Newborn King.
Thank you.
Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen and amen.